And again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last. Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman. He said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." Can you say amen?
Amen.
I want to preach, teach, and share with you from this thought here. Who's zooming? Who? Y'all know Aretha Franklin popularized this song, "Who's Zooming Who?" And basically the backdrop of this song has to do with individuals recognizing that the very person you scoping out may just be scoping you. As if the guy thinks that in reality he didn't pull one over on the woman, when in truth the woman all of the time already had him in her scope of view, a frame of mind. Matter of fact, she was a little bit better at it than he was. And it's interesting when we think about this lesson today, because this woman who has been caught in the act of adultery, she has been singled out. She has been called out, if you will. And we don't know exactly what scenario led to this woman being caught up in this embarrassing public scandal. But what is apparent is that she is the alleged offender and she is a victim as well. Alleged offender because she got caught up, but victim because she is being made to face the consequences of actions that require a man and a woman. It is interesting what we do in our society to create our own sense of peace and well-being. You know, we will do things to elevate ourselves and malign other folks. Another way I thought about approaching this text today was appropriating, of course, for the sanitized version of Kendrick Lamar's "I'm a Sinner." And I'm probably going to what? Sin again.
Well, let me help you.
Lord, forgive me. Do some things people just don't understand. And then it says, "Witch, don't kill my vibe."
I sanitize.
But oftentimes, we want to see people as tools or objects that we can manipulate just to satisfy our own selfish, carnal nature. Somebody don't catch that on the way to the parking lot. But here, as we grapple with this text, We got to understand and know that religious people are just as guilty of sin as the openly immoral sinner. It's devastating to look at the news and hear the news today about 50 people being killed in Orlando, Florida, and 53 injured in Orlando, Florida. But see, the other thing that we have is that it happened at a gay club. And we tend to find folk in this problematic society in which we live who have decided to take the law into their own hands and deliver their own semblance of justice. But I stop by to let you know that regardless of how you feel or what you think about that gay person, that was somebody's child. That was somebody's brother or sister that was killed or injured. And see, until, like the comedian says, until you come to terms with the fact that everybody got somebody in their family, we must become a little bit more aware that we got to live up to the same standards that we hold other folk up to. Because oftentimes we hold others up to expectations that we don't meet ourselves. Using the law and the Bible to bring others down, but never taking that same Bible. Oh, I wish I had somebody to talk back to. That same Bible that you talk and use to send everybody else to hell. If you don't obey it, you're going to find yourself. Right next to them. The beautiful thing and honest thing about the Word of God is God's law condemns all of us. Are y'all listening to me? Because when we look at the book of Romans, it lets us know that all have sinned. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. And come short of the glory of God. And so when we began to recognize that all of us have sinned, that helps us to recognize that there is no such thing as a big sin and a little sin. Or no sin is better than the next sin. Sin is when we miss the mark, when we break our fellowship with God, when we don't keep our side of the promised obligation that if God has saved me, then God requires that I obey His commandments and walk according to His statutes. And when I fail to obey and walk according to the statutes, I have broken covenant. You may not have cussed. You may not have lied. But when you miss the mark, you are just as guilty. And then I need to put this in here too. And if your particular sin is hidden from the view of the public, it does not make it any less offensive to God than the one that somebody is blatantly committing each and every day up and down the highway. It has been said, you know, adultery is the sexual act and it involves the breach of the marriage covenant, as Hebrews 13 and 4. But our generation has been called an adulterous generation. Now, when we talk about our generation being an adulterous generation, it's not just simply talking about people who have committed sexual misconduct with respect to marriage, but we see that our generation has become an adulterous generation because adultery property has either directly or indirectly affected the whole society. No matter where you look, you will see it being played out that it's because somebody has broken covenant. I praise God when we think about this lesson today, because again, I need to argue the case for us to see that there is no gradation of sin.
That's right.
Now, a Jewish custom, they rank adultery as one of the top three sins. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Adultery was one of the top three most serious sins. It was up there with idolatry.
Okay.
It was up there with murder. And so idolatry, murder, and adultery were the top three sins. But I contend that all of us, like this woman, have been caught in the act of sin. And we stand condemned because we have broken covenant with God. And yes, 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 you know, we got all kinds of ways to like, well, they keep that twist, me and you, and you know, I ain't gonna tell nobody. You know, you act like this is the first time you heard it. I don't know the lines that people use. Say, I need you to keep this kind of under, you know. But I need you to understand something. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13. I gotta help a little bit before I move on. Hebrews chapter 4, round about verse 13. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, it says, and there is no creature hidden from his sight. Is that what it says in your Bible? It's letting us see here that no one is hidden from the sight of God. I don't care if it happened at night. I don't care if it happened in a remote location. There's no creature hidden from his sight. Watch this. But all things, doesn't it say in your Bible? It didn't say some things. But it says, but all things are naked. That means you can't dress it up no matter how you try. That means you can't camouflage. But it says that all things are naked and open. Now see right now, it's saying here that no matter how you may sweeten it with flowery words and how you may put perfume and cologne on it, it lets us know that all of our motives, all of our actions are naked and open to the eyes of him who we got to give an account to. Now you may have duped her, you may have tricked him, but guess what? You got to give an account unto God. Says you got to give an account, not to the individual, but to God. You know what's interesting? Just the other day here in the city of Pasadena, a young African-American female, Jasmine Richard, was convicted of felony lynching. She was caught in the very act on camera. And according to California Penal Code Statute 405A, in response to the Wild Wild West mentality, when a person participated in the taking of an individual by means of a riot from the lawful custody of a peace officer, this was perceived as lynching. This was perceived as an individual taking the law into their own hands and delivering their version of justice without due process of the law. However, Pasadena City Attorney, which happens to be a black woman, along with her staff, have appropriated a legal angry black woman. When this characterization was brought to my attention, I thought about Karen. I'll say it again. I said, when this characterization was brought to my attention, I thought about Karen. I thought about us.
All right.
How do we view one another? How do we relate to one another when it comes to showing restraint and seeing one another as being made in the image and the likeness of God? Do we look at people through the lenses of our own biases and prejudices, or do we look at people the way Jesus looks at them? Are we passing judgment on folk because we saw them coming out of the room together? Are we thinking the worst because we know that that woman surely can't afford a Maserati based on her income? Are we making judgments about people and biases? Well, because he has that tie on, or because she has this zip code, they think that they're all of that. Traditional interpretation of this text gets glossed over, a sidetrack, because of our desire for modesty around the topic of sexual sin, which is more of a private nature. So we kind of
get quieter.
But I want you to know that this particular pericope, this span of scripture here, is not simply about sexual sin, but it points out that the world and humanity needs compassion and forgiveness. Our community and our nation is on the brink of chaotic destruction because we lack compassion. The reason we see what's going on in the political arena is because we lack compassion and we are reluctant to forgive one another. And Jesus Christ, I make my way to where I need to be now, but Jesus Christ, he models for us, if we are to really live up to our core values of influencing community values, if we are to really influence the community and make an impact for Jesus Christ, then we've got to decide whether or not we're going to be forgiving and compassionate toward one another. You see, the church would fill up if we learned how to be compassionate and forgiving. You're sitting by people and down from folk and around from folk that you're still mad at because they didn't buy a fish plate from you.
Example of principle that Jesus models here in this text, and
In John chapter 8, if you go back to John chapter 8 with me, the first thing that Jesus models here is here that after they had been on this excursion up to the Mount of Olives to retreat, verse 2 says, early in the morning, he came, what does it say in your Bible? Again to the temple. So what we see here is that Jesus is consistent in his attendance at the temple. Jesus is not a drive-by participant when it comes to temple worship. But Jesus, the Bible says, he shows up again. And that word again would imply that he's been there before. And that would help us to recognize that if there is a commitment to consistency, Jesus, of all persons, he had many reasons not to go to temple. People were hating on him. He had various places to go and people to see. But Jesus Christ did not allow the busyness and the drama around him to distract him from being consistent with respect to his responsibility and his role at temple. Matter of fact, when his parents, Mary and Joseph, could not find him, they had to go back to the temple and found him in the temple talking with the elders, and they asked him, why did you do us this way? He said, did you not know that I must be about my father?
Now stay with me now.
competent and qualified you are, somebody is going to challenge you. I don't care how sharp and intelligent you are, somebody is going to try to trip you or get you caught up with respect to your knowledge base. They were trying to trap Jesus. And the best way I can explain this is that there's an ancient Jewish conundrum that says, have you stopped beating your wife? Have you stopped beating your wife? If you say yes, you are admitting to beating your wife. If you say no, then you're admitting that you haven't stopped. So they were trying to present this kind of scenario to Jesus, trying to trap Jesus on the laws of Moses. And they were saying, well, Moses commanded that this, and so they began to refer back to the Pentateuch, Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 22, and Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 10. But let me show you how sometimes people can be so low down, trifling, and tricky. Mm-hmm. Now, Leviticus 20 and 10 says that if a man is caught committing adultery, he is to be stoned. That's Leviticus 20 and 10. It says that the man who has committed adultery, he is to be stoned. But then when we look at Deuteronomy 22 and verse 22, it says that if the man and the woman are caught, both of them ought to be what? Stoned. Now what's wrong with this scenario already? Well, Leviticus 10 says that the brother ought to be there, and Deuteronomy 22 and 22 said that the brother ought to be there. But the only person that is there is the woman. And so you see how the Jews valued the woman. You see how they treated the woman. And this insensitive and knee-jerk carriage of justice was flawed. Because hundreds of years have proven earlier before this actual text was written that the law was given by Moses, but they had no record of anyone ever actually executing someone for committing adultery. And John had recorded earlier, the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. John 1 and 17, it says that the law, stay with me now, the law was given by who? Moses. But grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So really, all Jesus has been saying and demonstrating ever since John begins to write his account was that regardless of what the law says, you need to recognize that Jesus is Lord. You need to recognize that Jesus has now brought about a transformation in the law. Grace and truth now reigns. Jesus does not yield to temptation. He's consistent in his dedication and his determination. And one of the things that is so powerful here, Jesus does not engage in going tit for tat with these folk. And that's how I know that it was a lot of us in the crowd. So Jesus, when they presented him with this trick question, the word of God says Jesus just stooped down and started using his finger to write in the ground. Jesus began to focus as if he didn't even hear it. And this is how I know some of us was there. Look at verse verse 7 says, so some folk won't leave well enough alone. They continue to ask because they were seriously intentional about making sure that this woman was penalized. They continued to ask. And because they were being persistent in their questioning and pressing of the issue, Jesus awakened their conscience. See, some of us, oh, I wish I had a full church. Some of us, you know, it's easy to look down our noses at other folk. It's easy for us to make fun and walk around with a high and mighty attitude. But sometimes the Lord needs to awaken our consciousness. You see, sometimes we, the old folk used to say, let your conscience be your guide. See, don't nobody know like you know whether you're really who you say you are. Say, one of the most deadly things for a believer could be is to receive an anonymous note from somebody saying, you are phony and I know I'm right about it. Just imagine if an anonymous person sent you a note saying, you phony and I know I'm right about it. Huh? Oh, I just think about it. See, because sometimes, again, we go around with seared consciousness, but Jesus awakened their consciousness by after the temptation and the continuous pressing. Jesus stops writing and he asks them, "Who in here had never made a mistake?"
Come on, say it.
Oh, I wish I had a full church. Who in here had never made a mistake? And Jesus, he wasn't simply saying, leave the woman alone, let her go. But he was basically saying, whoever has never made a mistake, you throw the first stone. You see, Jesus was simply saying, nobody is perfect. Jesus was simply saying, every now and then, we need to do our own personal assessment and examination. While we're busy trying to point out the law in other folks' eyes, we need to get the twig out of our own eyes. Are you walking with me? And so when Jesus awakened their consciousness, this is gold. When Jesus awakened their consciousness, the Bible says here that they began to walk away, starting with the old, down to the young. Now, I got to help you. So it says to me that he was saying that the older you are, the more conscious you are to be that you ain't. No,
But instead of us getting closer and drawing nearer, we walk away. Here it is in this lesson. And they walked away. The Bible says that Jesus was left alone. I'm in verse 9. Jesus was left alone. And the woman was standing there in the midst. Y'all see that? And as Jesus is standing there alone with the woman, Jesus looks up and he recognizes that there's nobody there but him and the woman. And he raises the question, woman, where are your accusers? You see, in order to condemn and decide a case beyond a reasonable doubt, you gotta have witnesses. And see, we still don't know how many witnesses were in the crowd. It could have been one, or could have been, matter of fact, the man who was involved could have been in the crowd too. But here we see that no one is left in the crowd. And this is where we began to see how Jesus influenced community values. He simply says to this woman, where are your accusers? Where are the people who condemn you? Verse 11, she says, no one, Lord. Now, some scholars would say that this implied that in spite of this woman's behavior, in spite of her situation, she had some sense of who Jesus Christ is. Because she does not refer to him as simply teacher, she refers to him as Lord. And you know that there's something powerful will begin to take place in your life when you make Jesus Christ Lord of your life. She was simply saying that I'm no longer in charge. She perhaps had to deal with her own challenges of the flesh, but she simply said, Lord, nobody is here to condemn me. And Jesus, as I close, he simply forgives this woman and sets her free. Jesus, in mercy, he reaches out to this woman who is in misery. Jesus, in mercy, reaches out to this woman in misery and says, where are your accusers? You know, the very folk who should have been trying to encourage her, they were looking for ways to discredit her. But you need to understand that God calls us all to responsibility and accountability. Let me give you one more scripture before I go. Galatians 6 and 1. Galatians 6 and 1. This is for all of the sanctified folk in the room today. Galatians 6 and 1. This is for all the folk that have never messed up. This is for all the folk that have never made a mistake. Galatians 6 and 1 says, brethren, if a man is overtaken in a fault, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. In other words, to break it down, it's simply saying that if you find somebody that have made a mistake, if you know what it is to experience God's grace, you need to extend that same grace, that same forgiveness to our fellow man. That's why Jesus said, as he looked at the woman, neither do I pass any judgment or condemnation on you. He was not saying
Get it right, then continue to operate again.